can't. Do you wonder how can I be free from these issues that have destroyed my life? Well, my friend, I have the answer. Bible Way Hibner Memorial Church of God in Christ presents Chain Breakers, this and every Sunday at 9 a.m. here on WHYL.
From the L.B. Smith Ford Lincoln Studios, Oldies 102.9 is WHYL Carlisle.
It's time now for the Real Estate Radio Guy with real estate broker John Rainville. For the next hour, you'll learn everything about national real estate topics, trends, and news revolving around Central PA. It's sponsored by GSF Mortgage Corporation, EnviroQuest Inspections, and SearchHomesInPA.com. And now, here's the Real Estate Radio Guy, John Rainville.
Good morning, everybody. We're so excited. Hey, it was a foggy ride in today. What'd you think about that, Kinglsy?
It was actually kind of crazy. It was just that, just you know, that light mist where it's a pain in the butt to drive because you actually have to use your windshield wipers every once in a while. And if you don't have your defrosters on, like after about 5 minutes, it starts to fog up on the windshield. So aside from that, I think it's a beautiful morning. And I got a question for you.
Okay.
Did you use the restroom at all this morning?
Yes, sir.
Okay. When you flushed the toilet, did the water work?
Yes, sir.
When you wake up in the morning, just a quick question, do you get up on your own? Do you have an alarm clock?
Yep.
You have an alarm clock? Did that work?
Yep.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure that I wasn't the only one that woke up this morning and the world was still righteous because everywhere that I read, it was about to end. So,
well, you know, the sun came up, but it was a little foggy.
Well, okay. All right. I can go with the fog. I'm all right with that.
You know, and Al and I were thinking about, you know, he wanted to go bungee jumping again this morning. I had to calm him down because I was too worried about getting struck by a car on the side of the bridge.
Yeah, there's not too many cars off the side of the bridge. Maybe like on top of the bridge, but yeah, I think you're all right. So what do we got going on today?
Well, we've got a lot of good things here on the show today. We're going to be talking about what is a real estate broker compared to a regular sales agent, what makes the difference. We're going to be talking about that quarter hour with Colleen Zuck of CZ Tax Service. She's going to be explaining to our listeners all the things that they should be looking to do to save taxes from buying a house last year, talking about things that are deductible.
Did we plan this?
We did plan this.
Because it is kind of tax time.
It is tax time, okay. And we'll have her back on again closer to tax time, but this way people can start to get together some of the things that they get to write off. Hey, it's the biggest write-off you've got, folks.
Well, and there was a lot of new homeowners this year, so I mean, this is, you know, a new topic for a lot, and I'm sure we'll breach on some new information that even the seasoned homeowner doesn't know.
Yep, we're going to also be talking about what is a realtor. Realtor is a trademark. And it's sort of become a little bit like Scotch tape. It's actually a trademark, but people want to think that all real estate agents are realtors, and they're not.
Well, they're not all the same?
That. Nope, they're not. Hmm. We're going to give you 17 differences.
17?
17.
Not just the name?
Nope, 17. Wrote them down.
Wow. So it's kind of like, you know, being a doctor, but it's like Realtor John?
Correct. You got it.
Wow.
Exactly.
I kind of like that.
Absolutely. Exactly. That's perfect analogy there. And then our buddy from EnviroQuest Home Inspections, John Staz, is going to be coming on. John's got a really cool thing today. He's going to be going over monthly maintenance tips that you can do at your house every month just to keep your house in tip-top shape. And you'll actually be able to go onto our Facebook page, www.facebook.com/realestateradioguy, and we'll be happy to send you a copy of it. Very good information. You know, do three or four things every month and it makes, you know.
We're not going to just, you know, tell them to write it down and try to remember it all year long?
Well, they could keep replaying the show, but.
That's not a bad idea.
I thought a checklist might be a little bit.
more convenient for them. Yeah. I like the idea of having them replay every week. But
that way your wife can put it on the refrigerator for you, like your monthly honey-do list.
Just what I need.
You know, and you can check it off and get the little gold stars when they're done.
And she's, as you know, she's a teacher, so she has plenty of gold stars to give to me.
Well,
I haven't gotten any yet. I mean, after how many years of marriage, but maybe this list will help.
Well, let's talk here a little bit about what is, everyone gets confused in the real estate market. What is a real estate broker? What's a sales associate? And then after the taxes, we'll discuss about what makes them even different with being a realtor. But basically, folks, a real estate broker in most states has to be in the business anywhere from 2 to 3 years selling real estate. They usually have to take anywhere from 6 to 8 college-level courses after that. And then they have to take another exam and be approved by that state to operate as a real estate broker.
As a broker, not a real estate agent, a broker.
Correct, a real estate broker.
Okay.
So a real estate broker compared to a real estate agent who may have taken 2 classes and sat for an exam and gotten their ticket, gotten their license, a real estate agent has to work for a broker. They can't work by themselves. And so that's why they have to have things in their advertising and on their business cards, like the broker's, the company name, the company phone number, because most states want the consumer to know how to get in touch with the broker, because the broker is the one they're actually doing business with, even though they signed the paperwork with the real estate agent.
So why do I have to do business with a broker as opposed to just any Joe Schmo agent?
Good question. The purpose of a broker is the broker is responsible to supervise that agent. Okay, so that means we monitor their paperwork. As you see me looking at my cell phone sometimes, I'm actually reviewing my agent's paperwork on my telephone. Because of technology. And, you know, if we see something that's wrong, we point it out to the agent so we can get it corrected. We're also the go-to people in a company for the agent if they're having a situation, a hiccup in a transaction to come to get advice.
You're supposed to be the go-to person. A lot of people, they're kind of out of touch with a lot of these bigger agencies out there. You can't even get a hold of the broker, am I right? I mean, they have like office managers or sublings, if you will, that you have to kind of rely on.
That's an excellent point. Some of the larger companies, not picking on, you know, franchises, you know, there are everything from single sole practitioners who are going to be a broker, who can be a one-man shop, all the way up to offices with 300, 400, 500, 600 agents, all managed by a broker. A broker can manage more than one office. But a lot of times the consumers don't realize that they're actually hiring the broker to help them buy a home or help them to lease a home or help them to sell a home. So there's actually, that's, agent is representing that broker. And you brought up a great point there, Kinglsy, because a lot of real estate agents in some of these larger companies, they don't even know who their broker is. A lot of their office managers or their sales managers aren't brokers. It wasn't like that when I got in the business, you know, over 30 years ago. If someone was an office manager, they were an associate broker. So when a broker hires another broker to work for them, they end up being an associate broker.
So if I'm going to kind of understand this correctly, what you would call somebody with maybe a broker, some agents, or a broker that's always really on call would be kind of like a boutique brokerage, because you're, or should I use the analogy quantity versus quality?
Well, that's an interesting you know, topic there. I understand your boutique analogy. I think that many offices, many of the larger companies, are extremely well run, and they actually do have associate brokers in that office manager's seat. But we've seen many over the years with the downsizing, and we you know, we'd like to say, folks, that it's a Walmart world, everything's flat. So it used to be that a broker and an associate broker that was running an office got a fairly decent salary, and then they got override on what the agents produced. Because of commissions for the agents, with us trying to always give the agents more money, there's obviously less money on the management side. So a lot of those big salaries have gone away, and many managers actually, they work just strictly on override. So if their agents don't produce, they're not making anything extra.
Okay. So having the broker, if you will, kind of in the forefront of an office, not only do you get probably that realtor's expertise a little bit more easily accessible for your average agent, right?
Right.
But also by doing that, you are taking the brunt of a lot of overhead from a larger corporation, if you will, and having a more hands-on approach.
Yes. Actually, and there are several types of real estate brokers. There are what we're going to call selling brokers. So a real estate broker that has agents working for them, and they also still list and sell. And then when you go up to the next level, you may have them where their own that broker is only listing, or maybe they have buyer's agent that works for them, but they're still out there competing against their agents. Then after that, you would go to the next step, which would be a non-competing broker. Okay, so they no longer are selling.
Figurehead.
Right. They're more than a figurehead. They're actually just running the business, staying on top of things, trying to keep their agents, you know, at the forefront of technology and what's going on in the industry. And then once you would get beyond that, you would go to something that I would call like a legacy broker. And, you know, Central Pennsylvania had a bunch of them over the years. You had Mickey Molinari with MGM, Coldwell Banker. You had Jim Grandin and Jack Gaughan. You had Mr. Detweiler with Detweiler that rolled into being a Howard Hanna. You have Dan Pishnary with Century 21 Pishnary, Sue Helm. People that are known to be a real estate broker out there in the industry. And those all those folks I just mentioned, they ran their companies.
So more or less it was, when you talk about legacy, it's more or less name recognition. Because they're really not an acting realtor anymore. It's just people recognize the name and the brand.
More than that, those individuals that I mentioned all made major impacts on the real estate industry in Pennsylvania. Either through franchising, through new homes construction, they all really added to the business. They're all really many brokers, such as myself, for example, came out of Mickey Molinari's shop. Okay, she produced approximately at least probably a dozen other companies came out of her company. That doesn't always happen.
Hmm.
Okay, out of my company, we've already had three. We've had a New York company come out of us. We've had a Virginia company come out of us. We have a competing Pocono company where they came out from us. And that's one of the, in my opinion, one of the highest forms of flattery is for one of my agents to get to that point where they get a broker's license and they want to open their own shop.
Hmm. So that's kind of like, I'll use an NFL analogy, with Green Bay, obviously, here in the finals. There's been how many coaches that have worked under Holmgren that have branched out and then branched out from there? So kind of the same deal where they learn expertise from somebody that's obviously good at what they do, and they're good at teaching others. And obviously they recruited the right people too.
That's correct. That's correct. Well, we're getting ready to bring on Colleen Zuck of CZ Tax Service, and we're going to be talking a little bit with her about how you can save taxes with home ownership.
How do you save taxes with home ownership? I mean, my God, ever since I owned a home, it seemed like that honey-do list that you told me I had to put on the refrigerator keeps adding expenses. So please, Colleen, tell us how we can actually get some of that money back from home ownership. Good morning. How are you doing today?
Hi. How are you?
Not too bad. How are you feeling this morning?
Pretty good.
Did your sink work this morning?
It did.
Okay, just making sure. I just want, you know, I'm trying to, you know, check the whole area, make sure everybody's alive and everything's working.
Everything's working.
So, Colleen, tell me a little bit about yourself. How long have you been doing taxes?
This is my 14th year doing income taxes. I have an office at my outside of my home. Pretty much offer, you know, doing income taxes, you know, LLCs, corporate services, payroll, bookkeeping, and partnerships. I deal with a lot of Schedule A's, itemized deductions, and pertaining to mortgage interest, real estate taxes, points, all of those kinds of things as well.
And you've been doing this for 14 years, so... I imagine over the years you've figured out how to do it accurately.
Correct.
And I'm sure there's a lot of tips for all of our listeners out there that most of us probably, or some of us at least, don't know all of them. So, John.
What are some of the... Hi, Colleen. Good morning. What are some of the deductions? Because we had a lot of people that bought homes last year that I always recommend that they come to a tax professional like you, at least to do their first year's taxes, because there's a lot of write-offs. I mean, I've learned so much from you over the years about things that I should have been writing off years ago, and I'm just starting to write them off. So can you sort of go down maybe some of the things that are deductible when you bought a house last year?
The biggest tax break is your mortgage interest. Along with the mortgage interest, you have your real estate taxes. You have your private mortgage insurance. That is still effective for this tax season. For the Protecting Americans from the Tax Hike Act of 2015. So deducting that is available again this year. Like I said, you have your real estate taxes, property taxes.
One of the, I guess, important things for anyone that bought or, you know, we were saying buying or sold a property last year, they should bring you their closing documents, those what we call the TRID documents, like all the closing paperwork. So in case they had, like, points on a mortgage that they paid, they get to write that off, correct?
Correct, yes.
And, Colleen, if I'm selling a property and I pay closing costs, is it true that I get to write them off and the buyer also gets to write them off? And that's the only time IRS actually lets a dollar be counted twice?
Correct. The other thing is, as far as, you know, if you purchase the property, your real estate taxes on your settlement sheet, it'll show what real estate taxes you paid as a home buyer, and that's deductible in that year as well.
Really? So I sell a home, right? I'm just going to go through a scenario here. So let's just pretend I sold a home and I come to you, and I had somebody buy a home for $100,000, and when they bought it, I actually, as a seller, conceded to them 3% towards closing costs, let's say. So in the actual sales process, I said, look, I'll cover $3,000 of your seller's closing costs, right?
Right.
And then, of course, I have my own closing costs as I'm selling the home as well. You know, the realtor and maybe some title work, etc. So of that 3% and of the other closing costs, is all of that tax deductible on the sale of a home?
It is.
Wow. And the buyer also gets to write off. Now, here's the question. So let's say they have $10,000 in seller's closing costs, and I offer to cover three. Do they get to write off the whole 10 or just seven of it?
They get to write off the whole 10 of them. And then whatever they had paid for real estate taxes as well.
Wow. So they're actually getting a benefit over and above what their closing costs that they actually had to come to the table with from purchasing a home, the actual buyer.
Correct.
Wow, that's a nice jump start in home ownership.
It is. There's a lot of things with buying a home, a lot of advantages that you have in order to do that. I mean, as far as if you're a first time home buyer, you can withdraw from your traditional IRA with penalty free. There's so many perks to buying a home and then being able to deduct those expenses on your income tax return.
Colleen, somebody just handed me a question. We've done a lot of short sales and foreclosures also in the past year. And if someone, I know some of the banks or the lenders are 1099-ing people for like the shortfall. So let's say they had a $100,000 mortgage and they ended up selling the home for $70,000. And then all of a sudden, last February, they would get a 1099, a form saying that almost looks like they got $30,000.
Banks are still doing that?
Yes, it's a canceled debt, so that amount would be taxable
income. Wow, so they can't even write that off then, that $30,000, that's income now.
That's income, yes.
Wow, so I guess there's no way to know going in whether or not you're going to be burdened with that at the end of the year.
Correct.
Is there any exception to that?
I mean, if it's reduced by their mortgage, the restructuring of it and everything like that. There's a lot of banks that are doing the 1099 cancellation of debt, but they're trying to. I mean, it carries that tax burden.
Okay, so if somebody sold their house last year and it was a short sale or a foreclosure. And, in February they get that. When they come to you to bring their taxes, they shouldn't be pitching that in the trash. They need to bring that to you, correct?
Correct, yes, because that would be treated as your, taxable. It would go on as taxable income.
And just so the listeners know, it's kind of like getting a W-2.
Correct.
Those forms are also filed with the IRS, so it's not like you're going to hide it from them as far as that income just didn't, happen to end up on my tax returns because I lost the form.
Right, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, once everything's reported to the IRS, it's on your transcript, and then that way when your tax return is submitted, they look through it, they can see exactly what should be on it.
So, Colleen, let's say that we moved out of state. Can I deduct any of my moving expenses?
It depends how far you're going and for what reason.
Let's say for a job, and
as long as it's a certain mileage, away from your first home that you were living at, then yes.
Now, are we talking, when you say mileage, from Mechanicsburg to Carlisle, or are we talking from Mechanicsburg to Philadelphia kind of mileage?
It depends on the mileage and the job and everything else. Typically, if you're moving out of state from Mechanicsburg, then yes. If you're taking a position somewhere else, just the same as job search expenses are deductible as well. So there's all those kinds of things. It gets gets a little tricky when you start doing, you know, things of that nature.
Because I know a lot of employers, you know, usually, for example, like police officers, sometimes people in the medical profession, they have to live within so many miles or so many minutes of work. So I guess in that instance, like Kinglsy was asking, that Mechanicsburg to Carlisle might come into play.
Yes, yes. If part of your job, you have to live within a certain mileage. So in that case, if you're living in Mechanicsburg and you need to move to Carlisle to be closer to your job, then yes, moving expenses would be deductible.
Wow. All right. Save your receipts, people.
Yep. That's, I tell everybody to keep your receipts. Anything that comes in the mail that says, you know, tax return information, hold on to that ticket. You know, that all needs to be going on to your income tax return.
So let me just get back to interest real quick, because that's usually typically what your largest deduction as far as home ownership. So let's take an average home in the area of $300,000, and let's just say my mortgage payment is $1,800. Of that $1,800, obviously, they break that down into principal, interest, taxes, and insurance usually, right?
Correct.
So of that payment, when you're looking at your mortgage coupon, if you will, you look at your mortgage interest amount, and if you were to multiply that by 12, in essence, that's going to give you the amount of interest that you paid that year. Am I correct? That you're going to get that form in the mail from your mortgage company saying that.
Yes, you're going to, at the end of the tax year, you get your mortgage interest statement on there. It will break everything down for you, show you what your mortgage interest was for the year, what your hazard insurance was, what your real estate taxes were. It breaks everything down on there for you so that you know exactly what you're able to deduct on your Schedule A for that year.
So every deduction sort of adds up then, as I'm starting to understand this more. So they bought the house. They've now got that interest deduction. That could actually impact more than just writing down that amount of money that they owe, but it could actually change their tax bracket. Is that correct, Colleen?
Exactly. There's a lot of people that I've dealt with over the years. You know, you have your standard deduction, and a lot of people are just like, yeah, I'm going to go with that. You know, I ask every single client of mine, you know, do you own a home, or did you buy a home, all of those kinds of things. Let's give it a shot. Because a lot of times I've seen the mortgage interest is enough for them to be able to file the Schedule A. Then you add in your real estate taxes, you know, your mortgage insurance and all of those kinds of things, and they end up being over their standard deduction and being able to file their Schedule A to take advantage of those tax credits.
So,
but those are, unfortunately, a lot of clients overlook that and miss those deductions.
So in Pennsylvania, then we've got our property taxes and we've got our school taxes, which is a huge portion. So all
correct.
Of that is tax deductible as well.
Yes.
Fabulous. So one other quick question then for you, which I think is a little bit more confusing to most, especially first-time home buyers. I bought a home, maybe not so much this past year because we had spectacular interest rates, but let's say you know, the seller was, you know, offering to pay 6% of the closing costs, and you know, I had a few thousand dollars left over, if you will, from after paying the title and all the rest of that, that I decided to buy my interest rate down by paying points. So, and basically a point for those out there listening is basically prepaid interest. So if I buy points to say instead of have an interest rate of 4, I spend a point to get it down to 3.75, which saves me monthly, obviously, and over the long haul of my loan, quite a bit of interest. How can I write that off? Can I write off that whole point this year, or is there another formula that has to be used?
You would pay, I mean, you would be able to deduct that in the year that you did it. So the year that you got that extra, you know, point down, you would be able to deduct that on that year.
Wow.
Colleen, another question. second mortgages, home equity line of credits. Is that interest? Can I deduct that interest too?
Yes.
So I could actually use my home equity line of credit, go out and buy a new car, and now I can write the interest off. Or I could pay off my credit cards or something like that and write the interest off.
That would be, you know, that extra cash, if you're buying a car, that would be taken out over the loan's term. So say your term is 7 years, that would be taken out over that portion.
Okay, but let's say that I borrow against my home equity line of credit. Okay, so I've got that interest now, and I went and I used a $20,000 check from that, and I went out and I bought a new Ford Escape. My interest still on that home equity line of credit, even though I used it to buy a car, would that still be deductible?
Oh, I'm sorry. With the car, it would be only for the points. So whatever point deduction, that would be taken out over the term of that specific loan. As far as buying a car and all that kind of thing, you have your sales tax that you could write off on that, but you're not going to be getting that for the interest deduction on that, because it's, you're looking at it as the point, the extra cash from the point.
So at the end of the year, then, I'm going to get a separate form from whatever mortgage or bank that I've got that line of credit with for that line of credit. Am I correct? It's going to say you paid X amount in interest.
Correct.
So I guess this would be kind of a moral question then when you go to your tax professional. I guess the question is, A, if I've got a line of credit for $20,000 and it's maxed, okay, do I have to document what I used that $20,000 for, or would it be kind of assumed that you used it on your home and the interest is still deductible?
That would be up to the client to be forthcoming. And I mean, as a preparer, I ask everybody those questions.
And I would imagine you have to ask that question.
Yes, correct.
Okay, so if they came to you and lied, and you know, as you probably well know, there's, you know, people out there like that. If they bought a Ford Escape and they didn't put countertops in their kitchen, they could just say that I used it over the course of the year for miscellaneous items on the house, and then they would write it off on their taxes. I'm sure that doesn't happen in our world. But theoretically, it sounds like it might.
Correct.
But either way, all that interest would be tax deductible, assuming everybody was on the up and up and used it on their homes and blah, 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 blah.
That is correct.
Colleen, another question on property taxes. So let's say that somebody owns a home and maybe they have a vacation home. Would those property taxes, can they also deduct those?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, they can. As long as, you know, you can have an additional, it could be a boat, it could be an RV. As long as it has cooking, sleeping, bathroom facilities, you could use it as you have your rental properties that your real estate taxes are even deductible on that.
RVs.
Yeah.
They're tax deductible as well?
Yes.
Wow. So that would be considered like a big vacation home or something.
Yes.
Wow. Yeah. And yeah, big
you
boat
have to
too,
vacation,
right?
You know, when you're dealing with rentals, you have to vacation 14 days at your second property, so that the IRS doesn't consider it a residential rental property, you know, and
wow.
Stuff like that.
I guarantee you, I've got a lot of friends that, you know, go camping quite a bit and own motorhomes and RVs. I guarantee you they don't know that they can probably write a lot of that interest off if they've got a loan against that. Or what if they purchased it outright for cash? How would that work as far as your taxes?
You would get a form at the end of the year. You know, you have your sales on your Schedule A when you're dealing with, excuse me, the real estate and the interest statements and everything, you have your sales tax. It's the same thing I tell people, you know, you buy a cart and stuff like that. Keep your receipt because your sales tax is deductible.
Wow. So it almost makes more sense to finance the RV as opposed to paying cash, because it sounds like you get more of a benefit out of your taxes for doing it that way.
More benefit, yep.
Gotcha. And just a couple other basic questions. I mean, I'm sure you get this a lot, especially in today's day and age. There's still a lot of green incentives out there, is there not? Like for putting in special windows or doors or solar panels or certain roofs and such like that. So people that have done these small home improvements over the years try to obviously keep track of these, because a lot of those are still deductible, are they not?
Correct. The credit has been extended. So if you install storm doors, energy-efficient windows, asphalt or metal roofs, air conditioning or heating systems, you know, you get a tax credit for that. The same as if you install equipment using renewable sources of energy. That's also, you know, you get a tax credit on that. So, you know, as long as everybody saves their receipts and hangs on to that if they are doing those kinds of repairs at their home, you know, that there's...
Yeah, I know this year we had to replace our hot water heater, and we had a choice of going with the regular tank unit or going with the tankless unit. And I think there's a $350 tax credit is what the paper is that they gave us for going with the tankless unit, which put us down to really about the same price as the tank unit.
Wow.
So you have to... Wow. It's money you have to keep all your receipts.
So there's really a lot of things out there that, you know, I didn't even know about being able to write off taxes on both sides of a sale for a buyer and seller. And at the end of the day, it really sounds like there's no way for me to know everything, which is why you're around. So, Collen, I mean, this is obviously a busy time of year for you. Are you accepting new clients throughout this time of the year?
I am.
And if somebody wanted to get a hold of you and say, hey, can we sit down, let's go over what kind of write-offs I can have, et cetera, what's the best contact information for you?
You can reach me by phone at 717-623-1869, or I am on Facebook at ZTax and Bookkeeping Services 1040.
Can you spell that out?
ZTaxandBookkeepingServices 1040.
Awesome. We'll put a link to Colleen's contact information and her phone number and everything on our Facebook page later today. But I, you know, strongly, you know, advise you, if you don't have someone, give Colleen a shot. She does everything from individuals to business. Even if you haven't filed your taxes for the last 12 years, she will sit down and help you get current. She also does offers and compromise. So if you owe money, you know, a lot of money to the for taxes, you know, for back taxes, it well worth the call, because, you know, I consider her to be the expert that I use.
Yeah, I mean, otherwise, what are you going to do, go to Mexico?
That's possible. Well, Colleen, thank you so much. I know you had a late night at your other job working yesterday, so thanks so much for getting up with us early this morning. And we'll have you back on again closer to tax time so you can remind people about this, and we can talk some other topics with you.
All right. Sounds good. Appreciate you having me on. And tax season opens on January 23rd this year.
All right. Thanks, Colleen.
Enjoy your day.
Have a good day.
Don't bother, come on in. Are you working with a mortgage company that offers pre-approvals or just pre-qualifications? Does your mortgage company reward police, firefighters, military, teachers, and nurses with better rates and fees? How would you like to apply and be updated on the status of your loan right from your phone? Introducing GSF Mortgage Corporation, where technology and relationships make the difference. Visit pagoloan.com to apply or call 717-200-4800 for more information. NMLS number 1018.
Everyone wants to buy, sell, or invest in real estate. If only they knew the best way to do it. Hi, I'm John Rainville.
And I'm Kingsley Harmer.
And we're the Real Estate Radio Guys. We bring over 40 years' experience to talk about all things real estate.
Weekly, we'll discuss the latest trends, hot topics, along with tips and techniques that could save you thousands and eliminate headaches.
So tune in to the Real Estate Radio Guys, Saturdays at 8 a.m. here on WHYL 102.9. Real topics, real answers. Answers for real people.
Buying or selling a home? For professional home inspection, call Enviroquest of Harrisburg. Their certified home inspectors will conduct a thorough inspection and provide a detailed report with many pictures. They'll explain the findings. Do you have elevated radon levels in your house? Call Enviroquest. They have fixed over 10,000 homes over the last 25 years. For a professional home inspection or radon mitigation, call Enviroquest at 233-6144, 233-6144, or visit Enviroquest online at evqharrisburg.com. That's evqharrisburg.com. Searching for a home online morning, noon, and night, looking at website after website, clicking contact me, and nobody does? Missed homes that were sold before you knew they were for sale? The better choice is searchhomesinpa.com. Search if you want, or they'll do it for you. Contact by phone, email, or text to adjust your search, or to tour a property. Start online. They'll call you back at searchhomesinpa.com, or call toll free 855-919-HOME, and they'll do it for you. searchhomesinpa.com, 855-919-4663. Buying or selling a home? For professional home inspection, call Enviroquest of Harrisburg. Their certified home inspectors will conduct a thorough inspection and provide a detailed report with many pictures. They'll explain the findings. Do you have elevated radon levels in your house? Call Enviroquest. They have fixed over 10,000 homes over the last 25 years. For a professional home inspection or radon mitigation, call Enviroquest at 233-6144, 233-6144, or visit Enviroquest online at evqharrisburg.com. That's evqharrisburg.com.
Buying.
Good morning. John Staz is on the line with us. And as
good morning.
You know, good morning, John. How are you?
Good, good. How's it going with you guys?
I'm doing great, John. I have a question for you.
Sure.
When you woke up this morning, was your heat still working?
Was it on?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was on still.
It was still working? Okay, I just wanted to make sure. I'm just checking across the whole state to make sure everybody's still alive and everything's still working in their homes.
Not nearly as hard as last year at this time.
Well, that's true. That is true. I mean, it is kind of almost like spring weather out there. So
yeah, we had a nice little surprise last year at this on this weekend.
Yeah, we did. It was this weekend, wasn't it? I'm actually kind of okay with the whole global warming thing, if this is what it brings. I didn't say that out loud, did I? So, John, what are we going to talk about today?
Well, you guys wanted to talk about some home maintenance items, home maintenance checklist.
I think that's a good idea because, you know, I'm a guy. I already have the honey-do list, as John already told me, and he was so happy to offer yet another to-do list for me. But at the end of the day, without it, I think most of us forget some of this basic maintenance type stuff. So, we've got this awesome checklist that we've got offered from you that we're going to put on Real Estate Radio Guy on the Facebook page. And obviously, if they call you, you can obviously offer this as well. So, in a given winter, let's say, for example, and we're in January, I mean, how hard is it to just have, what, three or four items to just maintain your home, routinely just go through and check it off? I mean, how long does this kind of thing take you?
I mean, sure, a lot of the stuff is seasonal, and if you're able to do it yourself or you can hire somebody to do it, it's really not that bad. It's the key is keeping up with it as you go through the year. So, you know, wintertime, of course, you get some snowfall. You want to make sure that you have your gutters cleaned out and that your spouts and gutter systems are free-flowing, draining away from the house for sure. So when we do get the snow and ice, that you don't get things such as ice damming back up under your shingles or problems with your accumulating next to your foundation. You know, if your downspouts are clogged or draining too close to the house, for one.
All right. So I mean, on one of the, just to kind of give the listeners a little peek, for example, we've got our winter checklist, and obviously we're in January. And one of the things, you know, recommended to do is to check your HVAC filters. So how often should that actually be done, I guess, is the question. And what are we looking for?
Sure. It really depends on what filter you have. And if you do have an air-based system, the most common filters are the 30-day and 90-day filters. But they do make better filters that last up to like 6 months. So it's pretty nice having the middle filter, the 90-day. Makes it real easy. You just change it each time the season changes. So in a lot of with filters, with air filters, it's common sense. If you live next to a highway or you have a lot of pets or people smoking in the house, you probably need to tend towards changing it a little more often. If you go to change your filter and it looks real clean, then it probably doesn't need to be changed quite as often. There is some leeway with it. The biggest safety tip with filters is if you have a gas furnace, you want to make sure that you keep your filter clean, because what happens, a gas furnace has a heat exchanger, and if your filter gets clogged, the air will flow through across that heat exchanger unevenly, and you can get a hot spot or a crack on the heat exchanger, which is usually a fatal flaw. You know, once you have a gas furnace with a cracked heat exchanger, the whole thing needs to be replaced. But so that's the safety tip. And, you know, both for financial reasons and for the safety reason, is that when you get a cracked heat exchanger, there's a possibility that combustion gases can mix in with the air that's flowing through the unit. So protect yourself, you know, change the filter, and then also keep a carbon monoxide detector, you know, if you do have a gas furnace,
John,
or any combustion-based heating appliance.
I'm looking over the checklist, and it says, and I know last week we did a big session on garbage disposals. It says to clean the kitchen sink disposal, and that looks like a monthly item. And I know last week you had talked about running ice down through there. Then the next thing on there is about cleaning range hood filters. I don't think I've ever done that. I think I might have the original ones in there. What do I have to do for those?
Yeah, regarding the range hood filters, so, you know, you cook, there's grease, you know, moisture and whatnot coming off the range top. The most common type of filter nowadays is a recirculating filter, and, you know, those can get greasy. Some of them are made that you can put them right into the dishwasher and clean them and reuse them. I believe most of them are washable, the type that are in those range hoods. The safety issue with those, of course, is that, you know, especially if you have a gas or an open flame and then grease is going onto that filter, it could be a, you know, fire hazard there.
So,
clean.
Real quick question then, this is obviously pretty commonplace, I would imagine. With these range hoods that are over the stoves, you know, you tend to see microwaves now that are hanging over the stoves. Do they have the filters in them as well?
They do. And another thing you want to look out for is, you know, sometimes people do like a homeowner remodel in their kitchen, and they'll put that microwave or the range hood too close to the range, to where you have to bend over to see what time it is on your range clock. But so usually as a general rule, you want at least approximately 18 inches. You know, when they're designing kitchens, they usually want to see like 18 inches of clearance.
Okay.
Some places, I believe in Canada, it's like it's even higher. It's like 30 inches.
I didn't know that.
Clearance is required.
Wow.
But yeah, and that's for the fire safety aspect.
Okay, well, that makes sense. So these range hoods, including the microwaves then, what you're saying is with all this grease, you're saying could cause a fire hazard.
Exactly.
Which brings us to our next topic, fire extinguishers. I mean, I know I don't have one in the kitchen, but I'm assuming I should. I mean, I know where
yeah,
there is
dude,
one.
You should have one in the kitchen. Come on, man. Where do you have it, in the bathroom?
Well, I should, I think, some days. But, I mean, if I eat a Taco Bell or something to that effect, I might need that. But I guess I'm supposed to have one in the kitchen.
Yes, you should.
Just like the fire alarm, maybe.
Yeah, maybe one in the garage, maybe one down basement by your furnace.
Well, how the hell am I supposed to know that? I've never caught my kitchen on fire
before. Your wife is just, she's just adding to your list, dude. That honey-do list is getting so long.
Yes, it's big. So what kind of maintenance do we have with a fire extinguisher?
Well, nowadays, I mean, they're readily available. I would say just get, when they get old, you know, there's probably an expiration date, so just replace it, go to Lowe's and get a new one. I'll tell you what I do is I keep a real big fire extinguisher in my bedroom, in my closet. So, hey, there's a fire at your house, you wake up, you know, you might need that. You know, you might not be able to go to the utility closet and get it. So, to me, it's just a common sense thing. I keep a big fire extinguisher in the master bedroom, so I have there if they're in the event of a fire.
Well, I never thought I would need a fire extinguisher. It's never gotten quite that hot or steamy in the bedroom, but that certainly makes sense. I never thought about that, having it readily available. Here's an interesting question for you. Have you ever run into this, speaking of bedrooms? Like, they have these emergency kits where you've got bags or whatnot that are attached somewhere to a windowsill where you can throw these ladders overboard to have quick escapes. What kind of, especially in the wintertime, and you've got these fire hazards, what kind of protocol do you see or do you recommend, aside from the fire extinguisher? Maybe you've seen some interesting ideas as far as what families have done to prevent or at the very least have an emergency escape.
Yeah. So I run into this. We have some rental units, and some places are stricter than others as far as the inspections, but we have some where they said, hey, you know, there's no good egress or the egress isn't sufficient. So we do have some of those ladders that keep them right next to the window coiled up, and then we show the tenants how to use them. You know, of course, some buildings have fire escapes, but you want to have it planned out, you know, especially from where you're sleeping in case of, you know, a nighttime fire for the egress, a method of egress to get out in the event of fire.
Well, that's definitely, yeah. And I don't think we as a family had a plan for it, you know, aside from run, which I guess would make sense, but maybe a little bit more design plan. So, especially for, you know, these rental properties and commercial properties, it sounds like you've gone in to inspect to make sure that, you know, some of this stuff has been put into place, if you will. And I'm sure code in a lot of these commercial buildings, you have to put them up on the wall. How would somebody, what's the best contact information to get a hold of you to actually come by and maybe check that out?
Sure. Our office phone number is 717-233-6144. And then our website is ebqharrisburg.com.
All right. Hey, John, thanks for coming on today. And check our Facebook page out. We'll have a link on there for John Staz and also for this checklist throughout the year that you guys can easily just go through and tie into that. So thanks for coming on again this week, John, and we'll see you next week.
Thank you. See you next week. Have a great week.
You do the same. Thank you.
All right. Well, the other topic we wanted to cover today was what's a realtor? And I had told you earlier in the show, it is a trademark. It is a very heavily protected trademark. But there is a difference between a realtor and a regular sales agent that doesn't belong to the National Association of Realtors or to Pennsylvania State, one of the state associations, or local. Let me give you a quick rundown of 17 things that a realtor commits to. What the first thing is, they pledge to put the interests of buyers and sellers ahead of their own and treat all parties honestly. They also, number two is, they refrain from exaggerating, misrepresenting, concealing material facts, and they're obligated to investigate and disclose when situations reasonably warrant. So if they're walking through a home and they see a water stain, they should be bringing it to your attention. The third thing that they do is they cooperate with other brokers and agents when it's in the best interest of their client to do so. Four, they have a duty to disclose if they represent family members who own or are about to buy real estate, or if they themselves are the principal in a real estate transaction, that they are licensed to sell real estate. So that way you know that Sally Sue is my mother-in-law. So you'll know that, you know, I might be having a little bit more pressure to negotiate a little bit harder. Number five is that realtors shall not provide professional services in a transaction where the agent has a present or contemplated interest without disclosing that interest. We're supposed to let you know if we may want to buy your property. You know, that's only fair. It's ethical. I think that's one of the big things, you know, realtors are just, you know, held to a higher ethical standard. Number six, shall not collect any commissions without the seller's knowledge, nor accept fees from a third party without the seller's express consent. So if they're getting a $75 kicker for getting you to buy that home warranty, they're supposed to disclose that to you. Or if they're getting a kickback from the title company or the mortgage company, they need to disclose that. Number seven, we shall refuse fees for more than one party without all parties informed consent. Number eight, we're not supposed to commingle client funds with the agent's own. We're supposed to, for number nine, we ensure that all written documents are easy to understand and everybody gets a copy when they sign. Number 10, shall not discriminate on any basis.
Duh.
Yeah, you got that right. Number 11. Expect, you know, agents to be competent, to conform to standards of practice, and refuse to provide services for which they are unqualified. They may be inexperienced, but that doesn't mean that they're unqualified. Number 12, truth in advertising. Number 13, we're not supposed to practice law, and we don't practice law unless the agent is a lawyer. Number 14, shall cooperate if charges are brought against a realtor. Number 15, agree to not badmouth the competition and agree not to file unfounded ethics complaints. 16, shall not solicit another realtor's client nor interfere in a contractual relationship. We call that sign banging, folks. And number 17, shall submit to arbitration to settle matters and not seek legal remedies in the judicial system. So we're supposed to all play fairly.
It sounds to me like if you want to get, you know, your extra liver or kidney taken out, it's like either A, going to Tijuana, or B, going to an actual doctor. So at the end of the day, summarize, use a realtor. So that's pretty much going to wrap up the show today. Thanks for listening in. Real people, real topics, real answers. So tune in next week, and we'll see you again.
You've been been listening to The Real Estate Radio Guy with real estate broker John Rainville. Listen each week at this time and learn all about buying and selling, mortgages, market conditions, property maintenance, and much more. It's brought to you by GSF Mortgage Corporation, EnviroQuest Inspections, and SearchHomesInPA.com. It's The Real Estate Radio Guy, Saturday mornings at 8 on Oldies 102.9 and AM 960 WHYL.
Joe Rickey, Rice, good time, oldies, WHYL.